Welcome to another edition of The Sweet Spot. A little more than a week ago, Roger Ebert, who's a friend of mine and a great role model and inspiration to all film critics, the kind of the embodiment of film criticism, passed away. And you wrote a really interesting column a couple days later, talking about not just Ebert as the most famous film critic in the world, but also as this kind of extraordinary media brand.
No matter what platform, whatever his Roger-ness was,
yes,
seemed to translate.
And he went through all of these different media and embraced a lot of new stuff, including his wonderful blog and Twitter toward the end, which was especially important because his medical condition had taken away his speaking voice.
You think of his show, which was...
Right.
Can you go through the names with me?
The name of our show is opening soon at a theater near you. Two film critics talking about the movies. And this is Roger Ebert, the film critic from the Chicago Sun-Times.
And right over here is Gene Siskel, the film critic from the Chicago Tribune and Channel 2 News.
That was for a local PBS show in Chicago. And it went huge, and Siskel and Ebert were always on, you know, with Johnny Carson and David Letterman, cover of magazines. And those were the days when syndicated weekly television was a huge moneymaker. Gene Siskel died in 1999, and Roger brought his Sun-Times colleague Richard Roper, and they kept the thing going. And it wasn't Roger and Gene, but they managed to get a chemistry that worked. After that, when Roger wasn't able to be on the show anymore, they started bringing in some substitutes, and I was part of that rotation, and they got
I was wondering when you're going to get to it.
Yes, I was. It was, you know, me, other film critics, also people like John Cougar Mellencamp, Mario Van Peebles, Harold Ramis.
They cast the net fairly widely.
Yes. And then for the last year of syndication, what turned out to be the last year, when the show was called At the Movies, they hired Michael Phillips and me.
So what we're talking about here, this storied franchise, you essentially drove a
I killed it.
This is like it was made for YouTube.
It's like your own little vampire movie.
I think more, I don't think I drove a stake into it. I think, like to think of it more as that I led the funeral procession.
You called Roger your friend to start.
Yes.
To start the show. You guys didn't get off like on a great foot, did you?
I'm so glad you brought that up. I wrote a piece that was sort of my calling card into this guild of the world's film critics about Martin Scorsese before I was hired here. That kind of got me the job here.
Book reviewer or something.
Yeah. And so I made fun of his thumbs and of his uncritical, I thought, you know, too soft love for Scorsese and all of his movies, because he'd just written a rave review of Bringing Out the Dead, which I think, you know, I'm on safe ground as saying a lesser Scorsese effort. So I got hired at the New York Times, and he gave some. There was a piece in Salon where Roger weighed in on my hiring with basically the editors of the New York Times seemed to think that anyone could be a movie critic, and who is this guy? Has he seen six movies by Bresson or Ozu?
So you responded in typically mature fashion and did what?
I went to the video store and rented all the Bresson or Ozu movies I could get, and. And then, you know...
So he helped you be a better man.
And he also sort of put me on notice that he was an extremely kind and supportive person, as I subsequently found out. And also someone who was willing to change his mind, so that when I started writing, you know, at least adequate film criticism, he publicly took back, and in print took back, the mean things that he'd said about me when I started. And the lesson that I take from that is that he was very serious, but was also willing to let anybody in who was interested, who could do the work. When, you know, high school and college kids would write him letters saying, I want to be a film critic, like, he would always write back, and he would always say, you know what, keep writing. If you have something to say, find a way to say it. And I think, in a way, people talk about Roger rightly as this great sort of icon and superstar, but he was also a guy who had something to say, and he was trying throughout his career to find different ways to say it.
So
and in that way, he's kind of an inspiration, I think, you know, to a lot of us.
So whatever wave comes along, just surf it.
Yeah, and if you end up in the cafeteria with some guy drinking iced coffee, you know, that could work too.
Okay, a lot has been said
yes
about Roger Ebert. That doesn't mean that you are done talking. Go to the Arts Beat blog.
Yeah.
We'll build a little spot for Kaddish. Is that how you say it?
Kaddish, but that's okay.
Every time I try and go with the Yiddish.
That's not even Yiddish, but never mind.